about the brain in the past 10 years than in the previous 10,000. We're beginning to understand how our experiences out in the world translate into connections between the neurons inside our head. We're beginning to figure out how our perception of those experiences overlays emotional associations with those memories, and how the third of our lives that we spend sleeping helps our brains solidify and modify those memories over time. You know, the 3-pound organ that sits behind your eyes is nothing short of extraordinary. It's arguably the most amazing thing in the known universe. It may seem obvious, but I find it amazing to think that every innovation throughout the entire course of human history is made possible thanks to one organ. You know, think about that. From music to mathematics, from machines to medicine, government and philosophy, our ability to contemplate the world and recognize ourselves. It's all thanks to the brain. And one of the things that I find most perplexing about this awesome little organ is its ability to give us shared experiences. Think of a time when you've been standing around with a group of friends and someone lays out an awesome joke and everyone erupts into laughter. When you really think about that, it's someone using language to elicit a shared experience in another brain that's completely distinct from his or her own. Or to give you kind of a more tangible example, consider the World Cup. You know, when your team scores a goal, there's really nothing like that rush that you feel. The excitement is nearly tangible. Get the gist. You know, when you watch that, you can't help but feel what that guy's feeling, right? Not least because his expressions are totally amazing. But like, when you really think about it though, that's pixels moving on a screen and audio coming out of speakers hitting your ears, and that's enough to make you feel something. Why? How does the brain do that? We don't really know yet. But luckily for us, we live in a time of exponential innovation across many different fields, in both neuroscience and biology, but also in engineering, computer science, imaging, data visualization. It affords us an unprecedented view of the amazing organ that makes us who we are. And since we're at TED, and ideas worth spreading obviously originate within the brain, we're going to go on a 10-minute whirlwind journey straight through that brain. So I often think when I'm talking to an interesting individual that the brain and that person is kind of like a world. You are a world in a way. Your brain's almost complex enough to be. If you compared your brain to our home planet Earth, for example, you'd find some similarities. Except instead of being a round orb like our home planet, the brain would be covered in layers of smooth, very deep canyons, resulting in it having about 5 times more surface than our planet. That's important because, like the Earth, the brain has its own version of crust, cortex, cerebral cortex. The brain is covered in layers of gray matter, cells that are responsible for abstract thought, complex pattern solving, your ability to perceive yourself. Several layers of cells communicate both locally and send projections to reach out and connect with other cells, as you're seeing in this amazing visualization. When you're thinking or feeling or really doing anything, it's not just a single part of your brain that's active. It's lots of different parts, communicating tens or hundreds of times per second. In fact, when you're not doing anything at all, your brain is busy at work. You have what's called the default mode network, different parts of the brain that are active together, even when you're doing nothing. You could consider it kind of the heartbeat of your brain. Now, at this level, neuroscientists are beginning to understand how changes in wiring in the brain result in differences in brain function. For example, an interesting study from the Human Connectome Project found that in signal communication between different parts of the brain associated with our ability to switch tasks, patients with autism showed a reduced flexibility in communication. And in order to make more discoveries, they're doing something I find quite interesting. They're open sourcing their data and inviting anyone, anywhere in the world, to parse through it and help make discoveries. Now, at this scale, each of those little wires that you see, that's hundreds of thousands or even millions of cells. If we want to really understand the individual components of the brain, we need to look deeper. So this is a mouse brain, and we're going to fly through it, deep inside it, to a structure called the hippocampus. It's shaped kind of like a seahorse, and it plays a major role in memory formation, storing your experiences. The fuzziness that you see around this purple column of cells, those are dendrites. They're the tree-like branches of neurons in your brain. And they receive electrical input from other cells, and if they receive enough of this input, it causes a signal to propagate down through the dendrites to the cell body and outward through the axon, as you're seeing in this visualization. The axon, when the signal goes out, that actually reaches out to connect with other cells. And in this way, you get circuits that form in the brain. Now, this is one neuron among many. Your brain is made up of about 86 billion cells of many different types. We don't actually even know how many types of cells there are in the brain, which is, it's kind of weird when you think about it. Like, you know, we can land robots on Mars and we can image atoms, but we don't even know how many types of cells there are in the organ that makes that possible. It's a huge opportunity, I think, for discovery. But neurons, again, come in many different shapes and sizes, and different types of cells are found in different parts of the brain. One thing that's characteristic of neurons is their intricate branches. In fact, you have so many branches of neurons inside your head that I find it useful to step outside the brain in order to kind of fathom the complexity of these networks. If you lined up the branches of all the neurons in your brain end to end, they would stretch over 2 million kilometers. Your brain's like this big, and that would stretch from the Earth to the Moon 7 times. And the purpose of all these intricate branches in the brain is to connect, because neurons never live alone. Their purpose is to reach out to other cells and grasp them through junctions that we call synapses, one of which you're seeing here. Now, neurons through synapses send electrical and chemical signals. You have around 100 trillion synapses in your brain. Billions of them are active at any given time. In fact, if you remember anything that I've said in this presentation so far, it's because your brain actually grew new synapses. Now, we've zoomed in very far from the whole brain. This is nanoscale resolution, and this is the realm where I work. So I come from Sebastian Zung's computational neuroscience lab. We started at MIT, and now we're at Princeton. And we're focused on a field of neuroscience called connectomics. The goal of connectomics is to map out all the connections of all the neurons in the brain. And this is important because neurons actually process information at synaptic level. And if we want to understand how the brain works, we should probably know how the cells in it are connected. Now, the technology to even image cells at this resolution is relatively new. Consequently, our lab, like many labs these days, focuses on software. Specifically, we use deep learning, a type of computer science, to try to train computers to automatically map out neurons from volumes of brain image data. And now, the software is moving forward very quickly, but it's still relatively slow. It takes us, you know, tens of hours to map one neuron. 86 billion in the brain, that's like, it's crazy, right? So, in addition to building software, our lab has now started building games. We're crowdsourcing the analysis of our image data with a first-of-its-kind project called EyeWire. It's a game to map the brain, played by 150,000 people from all over the world. Our players solve complex puzzles, and as they solve those puzzles, they're actually mapping out neuron branches, which allows us to see which cell connects where. And instead of just talk to you about the game, I'm going to try an onstage demo. So, if we could switch to my laptop, I'm going to try to show you guys EyeWire, so cross your fingers for me that it works. Oh, yeah. So I guess I should say hi to the players. Oh, they're chatting. Hi, guys. Live on TEDxPuraVidaJoven stage. Maybe they'll say hello. So there's like 70 people online right now, and at any given time, that's kind of a typical number. So this thing that you see rotating, this is a real neuron. It's anatomically accurate, and it's actually a cell that's found in the retina. And it's actively being reconstructed by our gamers in EyeWire. It's one of hundreds of cells that they've mapped, and it'll probably be done in the next day or so. Hello from Greece. Welcome to EyeWire, they're saying. No, the puzzle game itself is a little bit challenging, so I'm not going to try to stand up here and map a neuron for you on the TEDx stage. I'll leave something to the imagination. Instead, I'll focus on what I think is an extremely, you know, perplexing part of this project. It's that you no longer have to have a PhD to make a difference in neuroscience. Our players range in age from 13 to 86. They're high school students, animators, sculptors, dentists, neurosurgeons, stay-at-home moms, retired grandmothers. It's people from all over the world who share two things in common. They like to play games, and they're interested in the brain. Now, our player community is another wonder in itself. You know, we have a burgeoning developer group. They've built these bots that can like query Wolfram Alpha, so you could, you know, find out the surface temperature of the moon if you need it in conversation. They've also built external leaderboard pages, and they can challenge each other to neuron mapping duels. Like, this is a real thing, and it's really amazing. Now, EyeWire is the first of what will be many projects in collaboration with other labs and organizations around the world that will mobilize gamers to help us make discoveries about the brain. In fact, the next project that we're working on will be reading memories by reconstructing neural circuits in the cortex. It sounds like sci-fi, but it's real, I promise you. So if we could actually switch back to my presentation. We were going on a journey through the brain, and right now we're at the neuron level, and that's not the smallest level that you can go. So we're going to go smaller than the neuron. We're going to go subsynaptic. What you're seeing here is a zoom to one of the 100 trillion synapses in your brain. The blue cell is filled with all these little yellow dots. Those are vesicles. They're little spheres, and they're containing neurotransmitters. It's a payload that when an electrical impulse comes through this blue cell, one of the little yellow dots, or several of them, are released to the gray cell. And if enough of them are released, it will cause a signal to be transmitted downstream. This is kind of what neurons are doing at any given time. Now, at this scale, we've reached almost a whole new world within the brain. It's the macromolecular scale. This animation that you're seeing is anatomically accurate. It's from Harvard University in ex vivo. This is a mitochondria. It's one of the energy-producing organelles inside each of the cells in your body. When you hear that your cells are synthesizing proteins from your DNA, these are the kind of machines that they're building. It's extraordinary. It kind of gives you a whole nother sense of appreciation for the complexity in your body and the fact that you exist at all. And we've now zoomed in a million times, from the whole brain down to the individual molecules that make up the cells within it. So I will paraphrase the Brain Initiative when I say that the challenge for modern neuroscience is to map the circuits of cells in the brain, to measure the fluctuating electrical and chemical activity moving through those cells, and to understand how their interplay results in our unique cognitive and behavioral capabilities. Again, fortunately for us, we live in an amazing time. There's unprecedented international, species-wide call for disruptive innovation, backed by billions of dollars of investment in neuroscience research. And it's calling for people from lots of different backgrounds, different disciplines, to approach the challenges or the opportunities in modern-day neuroscience from different perspectives. It's estimated that the Human Genome Project produced nearly $1 trillion of economic value. And I think neuroscience will rival that. Let me give you one example. Deep learning. It's not philosophy. It's not differential equations. It's a type of computer science. Basically, you can teach a machine to do smart things, like recognize objects and images, or recommend a new movie to you on Netflix, or help a doctor more accurately and rapidly diagnose a disease and come up with a custom treatment for individual patients. Deep learning, machine learning, is inspired by simplified artificial neural networks way back in the 1980s. 30 years later, it's revolutionizing computer science. As we begin to chart out the detailed structures of connections inside the brain, how will it catalyze the next generation of computer science? Now, an outside neuroscience is really just one area that innovation will take foot. The more that we know about the brain, the better poised we are to understand what happens in it when it goes wrong, and to be able to fix it when we have disorders. You know, we know embarrassingly little about what goes on in the brain and the crippling neurodegenerative diseases that rob us of our very selves. Alzheimer's and dementia, depression. We can't really do much about most of these diseases, but neuroscience stands to change that. And on the flip side, we're now better poised to understand what makes brains thrive and potentially amplify our own natural abilities. You know, imagine a future where you could enhance your ability to learn. That's actually already going on in labs at MIT. There's this group, Wilson Lab, and they can make a mouse learn faster by stimulating populations of cells in its brain to fire at a different frequency than they normally would. It's not inconceivable that within our lifetimes, we would be able to improve our willpower and determination. You know, banish worry from our lives, or make ourselves learn more faster. And one of the things that's most near and dear to me is curiosity itself. We know very little about higher level cognition, about the things that really make us human. You know, what happens when we wonder? What's going on in our lives when we feel inspired and we discover something and it leads us to have an idea that we turn into action? You know, neuroscience has never been in a better position to answer questions that have risen in men's minds, in humans' minds, ever since we've been able to call ourselves human beings. And on the other side, I think we'll be able to ask questions that our predecessors could only imagine. So I will leave you with a few wise words from Ralph Waldo Emerson, who may well have been an observing neuroscientist, when he said, "The world behind us and the world in front of us hails in comparison to the world within us." Gracias.
Thank you.